Grace to you and peace from God our Father and from our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. The part of God's Word that we will consider together this morning is our gospel lesson for today, taken from the gospel according to St. John, the second chapter, beginning with verse 1. 3 days later, there was a wedding in Cana of Galilee. Jesus' mother was there. Jesus and his disciples were also invited to the wedding. When the wine was gone, Jesus' mother said to him, "They have no wine." Jesus said to her, "Woman, what does that have to do with you and me? My time has not come yet." His mother said to the servants, "Do whatever he tells you." 6 stone water jars, which the Jews used for ceremonial cleansing, were standing there, each holding 20 or 30 gallons. Jesus told them, "Fill the jars with water." So they filled them to the brim. Then he said to them, "Now draw some out and take it to the master of the banquet." And they did. When the master of the banquet tasted the water that had now become wine, he did not know where it came from, though the servants who had drawn the water knew. The master of the banquet called the bridegroom and said to him, "Everyone serves the good wine first, and when the guests have had plenty to drink, then the cheaper wine. You saved the good wine until now." This, the beginning of his miraculous signs, Jesus performed in Cana of Galilee. He revealed his glory, and his disciples believed in him. This is the word of our Lord. Please be seated. Dear Christian friends, Jesus turning water into wine is not only his first miracle, it's also one of his most well-known miracles. If you drive up Highway 41, occasionally you can see a billboard that shows water being poured into a glass and it's turning into wine. It's generally for some winery, but sometimes it's actually about Jesus. But people recognize the picture, they recognize the image, even if they don't know much else about Scripture. And so while it's a well-known miracle, would you be able to answer the question, why did he do it? Did he do it simply because there was no wine and he was the great provider of everything that people want? Because that's actually the kind of savior people would like. You know, I don't have to worry about grocery shopping. I don't have to worry about doing the things that are mundane because, you know, God invented UPS, and he's going to send it to my house whenever I need it. If I need cash, he's in. If I want a vacation, he's got that. If I think that things should be different, he'll change it. People of every age have wanted that kind of savior, a savior that would do what they want, a savior that would whose will was the same as theirs. That's one of the reasons that people got so annoyed with Jesus. That's why they put him up for trial. That's why they said, "Crucify him." Because he's not the Savior that we necessarily want. He's the Savior that we need. Because he didn't come for people who had trivial problems. He came for people who were infected unto death. He came for people who had rejected God, who were born into sin and couldn't do a thing about it. He came for people who listened eagerly to what Satan had to say. And he came to open their eyes and their ears and their hearts. He came to rescue us from the prison of sin. And that becomes ours by faith. And I think one of the most fascinating things about this account of Jesus turning water into wine is it gives us a good image of what does faith look like. That faith that God gives to us, what does that look like? In the first verse, it says, 3 days later, there was a wedding in Cana of Galilee, and Jesus' mother was there, and Jesus and his disciples were also invited to the wedding. Because Jesus is a Savior who didn't come to be in an ivory tower. He didn't come to be inaccessible. Jesus came as a Savior for people. He didn't come for programs. He came for souls. And so it's no surprise that when he was invited to a wedding, he went, because there were people there. And he was sent to seek and to save people. And Jesus was always with people. When you read through it, he was with children, he was with adults, he was with people liked, he was with people who people didn't like, he was with people who liked him, he was with people who didn't like him. He was always with people. Except, of course, when he needed a break from people. Then he went off by himself to pray. But then when he was done praying, he came back to be with people again. In fact, that was one of the things that people didn't like about him. That was one of the things that people complained about, is that he was with the wrong people. He wasn't hanging out with the Pharisees and the Sadducees. Although, if you know the Pharisees and the Sadducees, if he'd have been with the Sadducees would have been upset. If he'd have been with the Pharisees would have been upset. But he was with tax collectors, adulterers, prostitutes, sinners. Because he came to seek and to save that which was lost. So ministry is for people. And not just people like us. Not just for people who think like us and look like us and act like us, who believe the same way we do. Ministry is for people of all types, in all places, with all needs, all kinds of history, because Jesus is the Savior of everybody. And then in one of the few appearances that we have of Jesus' mom, she does a wonderful job of showing us what faith looks like. It says, when the wine was gone, Jesus' mother said to him, "They have no wine." Because faith looks to Jesus. Now, Jesus wasn't a wine vendor. Jesus hadn't performed any miracles yet. So it's very realistic to believe that Mary had no idea what Jesus would do. She just knew if anyone could do something, he could. And his response to her, "Woman, what does that have to do with you and me? My time has not come yet." And of course, the word woman, if we'd say that today, it would sound a little disrespectful. But in Jesus' time, this was a term of utmost respect, because this was his mom. Jesus knew the fourth commandment, and he kept it. He honored his father and his mother. And this isn't the only time that he tested someone's faith either, is it? When the woman came to him and said, "My daughter is ill and no one can help her," he said, "Is it right to take the children's bread and throw it to the dogs?" That mean he didn't love that woman? No, but he gave her a chance to show her faith. And here, Jesus says, "Woman, what does it have to do with you and me? My time hasn't come yet." Does that mean that he's not intending to do anything? Does that mean he's testing her faith? How often do you run into that? "Lord, please heal me. Heal my family. Reach out to the one who is lost. Fix what is wrong. Feed the hungry. Help the poor. Help us get our ministry effective and reaching out into the community and into the world." And then it seems like nothing changes. People are still sick. People are still lost. People are still hungry. And then temptation comes. He won't do it. He can't do it. Maybe it's because of me. Maybe Satan whispers into our ears, it's because he's not listening or he doesn't exist. Because obviously, he's not doing what he's supposed to do. You asked nicely. You asked for a good thing. And he's not doing it. That's where the temptation comes. That's where the test of faith comes. Do we believe that Jesus' decisions for us will be best? Or do we want to harangue him until he finally does what we tell him to do? Because after all, we knew best all along. Real faith trusts God. Not only in the good times, but also in the confusing times, also in the bad times. Good faith does not dictate to God. Instead, it listens to him and trusts him. And so Mary said to the servants, do whatever he tells you. Because she knew that whatever he decided, it would be right. Faith not only focuses on Jesus, faith trusts him. And if that means I'm going to be sick a little longer, if that means it's going to hurt a little more, then God will use that to bless me, to honor his name, to extend his kingdom. It's easier to see in somebody else's life. Do you think any of the early disciples asked for persecution? Asked to be thrown out of their homes, of every place that they knew, and to go to places they'd never been? And yet we recognize that Jesus not only warned them it would happen, but he said he would use that to spread the gospel. And he did. Job certainly did not ask for the misery that he went through. And yet God used that to show angels what faith looks like. I don't know anybody that asks, Lord, please let something horrible happen to me. But Christians respond with, Lord, use whatever you have chosen to send to honor your name. And if I can be privileged to be part of your plan, teach me to trust you. The next part is something that doesn't happen as often as it should. It's a very simple point here. Six stone water jars with the Jews used for ceremonial cleansing. Now, of course, you know what that means, the ceremonial cleansing. When people come into your house, the ceremonial cleansing, this is foot washing water. And there were six stone jars because there were a lot of people, a lot of feet that needed to be washed. And each one of them held 20 to 30 gallons. And Jesus said, fill them. Now the servants had no idea what Jesus was going to do. All they knew is Jesus said, fill them. So they filled them. Any idea how rare that is? Where God says, do something, and people actually do it? It's not as common as you might think. Jesus says, read the Bible. How many of us do that? Jesus says, share your faith. How often do we do that? Jesus says, worship him with your family. Jesus says, be humble and forgiving. And yet how often do people hang on to grudges and say, I can't or I won't? Jesus says, love each other the way I loved you. That when somebody sins against you, your response, Father, forgive them. So they don't know what to do. And while our sinful nature is crying out for vengeance and justice, Lord, squish them, smite them, they deserve it. Faith is saying, bless them. Hold them up. That same forgiveness that you gave to me, that same welcome you gave to an undeserving sinner, that same washing of regeneration and renewal, give it to them. the joy that I pray for myself. I want them to have that same joy. Granted, filling water jars is easier than all that. But it's done by faith. When we offer forgiveness, when we choose to work together instead of being divisive, when we choose to honor the Lord instead of seeking our own honor. That's what faith looks like. They took it to the master of the banquet, and when he tasted the water that had now become wine, he didn't know where it came from, though the servants who had drawn the water knew. And he recognized, this is really good stuff. You know, that's not the surprising part, that Jesus would make really good wine, because he invented wine. He also invented the human palate, so he knows exactly what good wine should be like. That's not the surprising part. The part that we want to take home, how many people don't know where the blessings come from? The master of this banquet is about to taste some of the finest wine ever made. Definitely the most miraculous wine ever made. He didn't know where it came from. And yet he got to enjoy that. Faith blesses people, even when they have no idea where that came from. Jesus said, God makes it rain on the evil as well as the good. He brings life and joy and happiness, even when they don't know where it came from. He provides people with the things they need for daily life. He provides hope. He provides a plan. He provides a reason for living. But the one thing that people desperately need to know is that he also provides salvation. That was the most expensive of all the gifts. Because you consider where all the mundane gifts come from, where the trees and the plants and the oxygen and the stars and all those things came from. He just said, let there be, and there was. But salvation, he sacrificed everything for that. That cost the blood of God. He was judged by his own Father. He suffered to the depths that we can't even begin to imagine to purchase salvation for us. What greater gift? And that how many people don't yet know? And that's where we come in. Jesus says, go, make disciples. Baptize them, teach them. Bring them into the family. And how many reasons do we give him for not yet? Or not them? Or not me? And Jesus says, go. Because people are dying without him. And he's shown himself for who he is. He is the Savior. He did come for everybody. And salvation is free for all. Because he died and he rose again. This, the beginning of his miraculous signs, Jesus performed in Cana of Galilee. He revealed his glory. And his disciples then and now believe in him. Amen. And the peace of God that surpasses all understanding will keep your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. Amen.